one of the, it is the biggest religious faith-based organization in the country, in the prison system. And they told me that I got an open door for August the 10th. Come in. They're gonna let me tour the facility, tour what they're doing, and then I still got an opportunity to give my testimony. So, thank you for your prayers. Thank God for opening up that door. You just don't know how I've been burdened about what's going on now. I was saying that, you know, to the pastor that, you know, we might have troubles out here. We got the same troubles in the prison. People not seeing this thing clear, not wanting to go all the way with God, not wanting to wait on God. See, there's a part there that you have to, I don't care who you are, I don't care how saved you are. If them people had kept helping Noah build that ark, they would have been saved. Stay on the ship. You deserve the ship. What are you going to do? You're going to be out there in the rain. And eventually, that's what the devil wants anyway, from all of us. He wants us to see this thing another way. And accuse one another every day. That way we can't see Christ clear. So Lord, help us to stay on the ship. Stay with God. Don't say I'm with God and I'm going to run off or go my own way. That's not right. That's not good. There's no good end to that. We're doing the same thing in the prison. They leave. But I made a vow to God. I said, Lord, you gave me this. And I said, if it's 1 or 101, I'm going to be there. Amen. And I'm going to give them what God said to give them. My purpose for being here, period, is to be the example I need to be. Get this thing down in my soul. Keep it. Do the maintenance. To be the example I need to be. Because I want to make it happen. I don't want to go to hell. It was hot yesterday. Well, it's even hotter today. I don't want to go to hell. Hell has no place for me. So Lord, help me to stay in my place, stay humble, stay hungry, and stay honest. Amen. And we're going to transition right here to prayer, because we need to pray. Amen. We need to pray. So on my right, any outspoken requests, make them known. Remember my wife. She's wore out. Yes, ma'am. Get it?
Sister Josephine from Kalamazoo.
Okay.
Has requested prayer for her brother across the seas. I'm not sure what country he's in, but he's ill.
Okay. Okay. Yes, ma'am. See, I have a seat. On my left.
Brother Tim, I don't want to sit on this testimony. I want to give God the glory this morning.
And it's running over, so I can pray.
Amen. Sister Hall. pray, dear Lord, dear Father God, you undertake in a mighty way. My God, this dear sister is concerned about her friend, dear God, moving to Jackson this year. Lord God, she's got a desire to be saved, dear God. So may you help her speak to her soul, dear Father God, and realize, may she realize that Christ is the answer to her situation, dear God. So may you undertake in a mighty way, dear Father. We thank you again, and we can bring every burden, every care to thee. My God, we thank you how you protected our Sister Kim's son, dear Father. My God, we're thankful and grateful for that, dear God. So may you help and bless, dear Father God, in Jesus' name. Speak to his soul, dear Father God, in Jesus' name. We're just thankful for your faithfulness, dear God. You're a wonderful, merciful, and a loving Savior who does all things well. What a mighty God who's able to do great things, of which we're grateful and thankful, my God. Save him to the uttermost, my God. We're thankful for that, Father, this morning. So may you bless the friends of this service. May you bless our pastor. My God, you bring forth your word, Father, this morning. May you meet the needs of the saints and the visitors alike, dear God. May you have your divine way, dear Father, in the name of Christ Jesus. We're truly you're worthy, dear God. You're a merciful and a wonderful, loving Savior, truly worthy of all our praise. So I ask you, Father God, you just have your divine way to this day. In Jesus' name we pray.
Thank you.
time, we're going to ask the brethren from Ohio to come up, connect it, and sing a couple of songs.
Okay. Turn with us, please, to the book with 2 Peter chapter number 1. Beginning at verse number 13.
Yea, I think it meet, as long as I'm in this tabernacle.
I think it meet as long as I'm in this tabernacle.
To stir you up. By putting you in remembrance. Knowing that shortly. I must put off this my tabernacle.
Even as the Lord my Jesus Christ has showed me.
Moreover, I will endeavor that ye may be able, after my decease,
all right,
to have these things always in remembrance.
Yes.
For we have not followed cunningly devised fables, when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory.
Thank you. Verse number 12 and 13 again.
Wherefore, I will not be negligent to put you always in remembrance of these things, though ye know them,
and be established in the present truth.
Yea, I think it meet, as long as I'm in this tabernacle, to stir you up by putting you in remembrance.
Go on.
Knowing that shortly I must put off this my tabernacle, even as our Lord Jesus Christ has showed us.
Thank you. We were talking this morning about a necessary legacy. Necessary. Not something that might not be, or something that you have an option, but necessary. Peter, this was sort of his valedictorian address. He was the last speech. And he foresaw death. God was faithful to show it to him. And usually, when people give in their last remarks, those are the remarks that they regard as most important and that want to be remembered. He said, listen, God has shown me this. It's good when you live close enough to God that he'll make known to you things that are good and in your best interest. Why? All right, because if there's something you want to get done, special preparation you want to make, God can go away. And you don't have to leave your apartment. Listen, now, shortly I'll be leaving. Whether we know it or not, most of us don't have much time left as we think we have. So it's good when we can recognize it, all right? It is now. Now, I want you to remember these things after I'm dead and gone. You know, dear, let me tell you something. It's good when you can be so concerned about the spiritual that even death won't face you. You understand? See, usually when you win death in the face of people, they forget about their convictions, about their concerns. But my concern is this. After I'm dead and gone, the thing that I've emphasized and talked about, I want to remember them. I want to remember them. You know, dear, let me tell you something. Right now, I'm in a similar predicament because what? I talk to my children now as maybe more fervently than I have before. Let me tell you something. Don't you know that if something would happen to some of us, this thing would be such a tailspin that you won't even know what the gospel is all about?
God.
The truth would be so remiss and so tangled up and compromised, you don't even know what the truth of God's all about. You go to prayer and pray hard. After I'm dead and gone, you remember this. And let you know that, see, wait a minute. He said, for what I preach to you is not cunningly devised fable. I'm not preaching on a fairy tale. This gospel doesn't save you entering heaven. You can mess with this gospel if you want to, but you won't be heaven. You can't revise it. Three dollars, I do it. You're best interest and put light on you. And we're not demanding. I want you to remember, because he said, now, there have been many of those who, because the gospel was so demanding, that they directed and twisted it for their own best interest. They thought for their best interest. You follow me? But don't do that. Don't touch the gospel. Let me tell you something. We, the church, in the predicament that is in today because people and ministers have backed it in their heart and changed to another gospel, which is not another gospel.
True. That's right.
And now, listen, children. Now, if your children have not been taught this gospel because you held on to it, they don't know where to go.
That's right.
And people come, oh, this man made, that man taught. Well, I do say you blessing and control with me and kill me. If you call this gospel man made by God, you will be blessing and control with me and kill me. Because the Holy Ghost has confirmed it. And he will send it directly against God. Come back to the gospel. Whether you like it or not. You like it, go about your business. Don't try to take it up. Don't take it by something else. Let me tell you something.
All right.
You are obligated.
My God.
It's not nothing. To lead your children enough, a legacy.
Amen.
And you can only leave them one if you have something to leave. Not only by precept, but by example. You understand?
My God.
Thank God if I'm going in the grave and Jesus the lady is coming. And my children, my God, come into something here and it's not just right, they'll recognize it.
My God.
And they'll serve for nothing less. Even though it might cut them thin. You follow me, please, Lord God. Now here, but I got to have something to leave them. Such as I have. You can't leave them what you don't have. You can't leave $1 million if you're not a millionaire. You follow me? You cannot leave the little truth if you don't have the truth down in your story. At the expense of your life, hold on to it. I'm about to get into this. Now, wait a minute. This is my last address here.
All right.
I might not come before you anymore. But wait a minute. Listen, listen. After I'm gone, I want you to remember this gospel.
Yes, sir.
And how it worked really well. And how it transformed whole cities, nations, and the world. Do you know this gospel? This very gospel has gone all over the world. Do you know, because the saints of God stood firm on the divine healing, it went all over the world. Paul Harvey had it, and the biggest broadcast station in the world came here. I got to tell you a minute. The British broadcasting came here and televised and put on record one of our services.
All right.
Good. Because we went through and they heard about it, and there was an attorney that was preaching and holding fast against secession, all this kind of stuff. And so she wanted to document how we came out here. And evidently, it had been so widespread, you follow me, children, they came here and to make sure that what was published was right. And they stayed here, had set up all of their machines and all of their apparatuses here. You were staying.
Yes. My God.
You found somebody, they were in New York at the time, but they found somebody who was standing.
Right.
And who was immovable. You follow me? Whatever. And now here's you. It'd be so wonderful if your children, God help us out here, can look back when they get in trouble.
Yes.
Mama didn't move. Daddy didn't move. Yes. And I know they were. Standing on his right, and because of that, I put all that I have on the line. I know that the original teaching of the Church of God is right, and you keep touching it. If you don't want it, that's up to you, but don't touch it. Don't rearrange it. Don't try to change it, glory to God. No. Now, the Bible speaks about men who arrest the gospel, change it, and there are those with itching ears. who don't want to live up to it anyway. They'll be impressed with it. They'll be impressed with it because they don't want to, they'll be scrambling and scrounging, trying to get rid of it anyway. And so then when somebody come along and with some commonly devised fable, well, in fact, you go for it. You're not going far. I'm just a tremendous anger, sir. He's a wait a minute. As long as I live, and after, I want you to remember the thing that God has given me for you. In fact, now, you cannot go to heaven and make this. You follow me? See, you don't have no option to do God. But I won't do about that. A sermon book here and pick out the one you want. You don't do that. Thank God. You preach what Jesus and the apostles preached and what they practiced. And not only that, I owe it to my children here. I tell them, you don't know what you're going to be when I die. And when we die, the old saints die. You might get a new company of people who diminish everything. Well, I got records of it. Everything that we've taught and what God has blessed, it be eradicated. That's it. And then you won't know which way to go. You have to, what really does matter. I know it's right because I saw mama and daddy practice it. And I know it worked. It worked. Let me tell you something, children. Listen, your children, they're trying to make it hit and all this kind of stuff. You should be trying to leave a legacy here.
Amen.
Have sold this thing. If you don't leave them something, they might never see it.
Right.
You can't depend on somebody else to do it.
Right.
You know, this thing can be revolutionized overnight, and you go, is this the church of God? Is that the saints, the old saints?
Wow.
Church of God and the old saints were minus from that dress. And this is what left them.
Oh my.
When they're in that situation. Yes. And then they start crying. Oh, I wish. It went back there when mama was living and when daddy was living.
My Lord.
And I'm sick here, praise our God. And I want prayer. But I can't go and pray anymore because nobody trusts God anymore.
All right.
Come on. Mama ain't doing it. Daddy ain't doing it. Oh, sister, listen to me. Listen. It would be better to leave them a legacy than leave them $1 million. So now I got insurance from my, I got $500,000 insurance for my children. They want, you better get something that's more valuable than that. I would leave them a legacy of truth and a doctor, a wonderful doctor than $1 trillion. And those you got, so you better appreciate it. If you got parents that stand on this gospel and teaching this gospel and practicing it and getting results, you better hold on to it. Oh, you better hold on to it. At the funeral, they left us a legacy. Well, many times that is a cliche. What was it they left you? See, you can't leave something that you don't practice, that you don't have. And then try to ditch it to your children and recommend him to them because they are not doing it. You owe it to them. You owe it to them. Train by the train up, shine where they should go. And when they're old, they might not practice it, but they know it.
Yes,
all of them might not practice it, but they'll know it.
Amen.
They're obligated. They're obligated for it because you proved it. Woo! And you proved it working. And you didn't deviate from it.
Praise
God.
Amen. Not another gospel. That's not another gospel. That's all there is to it. I think a lot of that's real. I've been through so many apostasies in 64 years. And it's all the way down to this group and that group, Church of God group. And one stopped teaching sanctification, one cleansing, one deal with divine healing, one said fasting and nothing. I'm telling you that. At ministers' meeting, they get together and make that decision. And all of them vote on it. I'm going to tell you, and guess what? And after a while, there's no consequence. They voted on it. They voted, you can wear well, a jury here and there, because they said, and that proves something. I'm telling you this. Got records of it. And you know what? And after a little leaven, leaven the whole lump.
That's right.
That's what they got wearing. That's what the finger ring, and then the birthstone, and then the clasp ring, and then a little BB in the ear, BB shot, and after a while, a little ring, and after a while, a chandelier. What? When you deviate, you don't know where to stop. You think you're getting by with it, you're doing something else. You're not getting by. feel God kept blessing me. Well, you cause your life doesn't mean you've been blessed. John Billy has lived a long time. Peter Boy Floyd.
That's right.
All those gangsters. For that concern. And the sunshine on them as well as did the saints. For that concern.
That's right.
But the chief blessing of God did it. Let me tell you something, sure. You better get something in your soul.
That's right.
That is immortal.
Praise God.
Something that all the devils in hell cannot do.
Listen,
Bible says when you find this truth, hide it.
Yeah.
But you don't let them steal it from you.
That's it.
I mean, preserve it. Put it in the ball so the devil can't get to it.
That's right.
Take it back from you. You know, I got some tapes. My first sermon with the old real tapes. I was like, I didn't care more because there ain't nothing to do. But anyway, you know what I do? I want to see if I deviate from anything that I stood for. I ain't playing no game. I want to see if I backed up because of pressure. Backed up because I want to see what I testify to because I know God blessed me here and then the devil maybe pressed me and tried to get me to shift a little bit. Let me see if I'm doing the same thing. If I'm preaching the same thing, yes, but am I practicing the same thing? Come on. We've been denounced by ministers, by groups, what? Because we wouldn't move.
That's right.
I mean, only one or two of us, maybe Brother Kim, standing up, no more than standing up. And ministers breaking right into this place. They're afraid of being denounced. You wish you wouldn't, but you can't denounce me.
That's right. Then you'll be longing
And he been through. Now all your children can hear that are perverted gospel. That's all they can hear. What the law said, those who preach the real gospel can't do it anymore. And now, if you have not taught your children, you're done. If you're not living for your children, you're done. Listen to your liberties. You ought to be willing to give the remainder of your life.
That's right, man.
I mean, if there's another flesh in this life, just for this gospel.
Yes, yes.
Don't you know everything that you do is making an indelible oppression on your children?
Yes.
And your neighbors. And those that you work with.
Yeah.
Right.
My Lord.
You know what? Listen, my daughter, this girl had cancer on the job. And so she said, my daughter had discussed the family. And so I tell my dad, and we prayed the prayer. And God moved on her. And she's on a check. We're not after money. We don't suggest that. But she was so moved by it. And all over. Let me tell you something. The greatest and most beneficial impression that has ever been made on me concerning this truth about a minister that I never met. He left a legacy. And my wife got saved maybe like 3 or 4 years earlier, way back in 70 years ago, when she was just young. And she's standing for this gospel. And so, and the old thing would tell me about him, but I could sense it was something about him that was genuine. And it affected me so deep. How Brother Richard, how he stood. I mean, he was so concerned every little detail of his life. And this oldest sister here was telling about how that her son, you already mentioned, would have spasms real hard. And so they said, now, well, when you get saved, there was a, what you mean about your child? And that's your heart. I'm going to trust God.
That's right.
And what happened? The day she got saved, she had one of the hardest one that they ever had. And yet, look like it wasn't coming out of it. And so he took Brother Richard. And Brother Richard, just after service, he hand drawn it. And God brought him out of it. And he died 75 years old, never having another.
Praise God, Lord. Praise God, Lord.
I mean, this is not a fairy tale. It actually happens. One case after another. And I can sense it. That truth. I was listening to this. And so, but he, never affected his minister. I got his picture, a book of him, this morning. Who was wonderful, and one of the biggest churches in the Church of God. Great Detroit, Sister Karen Doe. Remember that. And that William Dan Norman was there. There were over 800 people there. And they were standing firm. But he began to deviate. But he had such influence over Brother Richardson that God had so much confidence in this preacher that I mentioned that God saw that there was a possibility that this man might influence him because this man that he had taken to the war. Some years old, around the world. And there was a sister in Pennsylvania who supposedly had to get the vaccine, and she came back and said for her. And he said that she said, "You're not gonna be ill." So what the impression of the people around here in this country don't have sufficient faith. Lost their good preacher because they didn't have enough faith. God said, "Hey, you know what? You have to pray about it. If you're, I want to put responsibility on you. And if you don't get a blink and have a connection with God, then you lose your preacher." And that's what happened. That never been in the body. And this is not no gimmick, preacher, but this is real.
Amen.
This is real. Now, and then I say, and God left them a legacy. And as a result, see, my wife would tell me about it, and how it happened, and it just went all through me, and made such an impression on me, Nobody could change. When preacher backslide and apostatized and compromised, it didn't move at all. But that legacy that he left here, the other young minister. Well, in fact, I wasn't a minister at that time. I just got saved, but I wasn't playing no games. I got saved for real. And I saw the depth of this thing. And I was just in my latter teens too when I got saved. But I don't care what I had to give up. I wouldn't care what the thing that I had handed, because you might think I'm boasting. But anyway, praise our God, but it didn't make no difference. And the very fact that you would defer your salvation because some kind of offer they're giving you. Professor Fuentes and things, these famous things with Captain. But I mean, all this kind of stuff. You know, could have done the COVID box and all that kind of stuff like that. And a lot of other things. But I saw the value in God. And my parents were not church of God. I knew nothing about this gospel before that time. But I could sense it's real.
Amen.
And if it was anything, it was everything. And that's what kept me, what's called, I got it right. When you found that pearl of great price, you sold everything you got.
Yeah.
I sold out to buy that one pearl. What is all God for the Lord? When I found the church of God, I sell out everything. My habits, my promises.
Amen.
I give up whatever. Is it here? Anything else?
Yes.
What about Sue? Sue? What about Terry? Amen. What about Mary Ann? I mean, yeah. That's not actual. Come on, baby.
Preach the word.
Preach the word.
Be instant in season.
Be instant in season.
Out of season.
Reprove.
Rebuke.
Go on.
Exhort with all long suffering and doctrine.
This is what you should do. I mean, whether you're a ordained preacher or not, whether you're a licensed preacher, whether you're in the pulpit or not, you preach me. Right. You deliver the gospel to somebody, if you witness, that's all you're doing preaching. Come on.
For the time will come.
All right. Listen to me, saints of God. You need something for your children. Because the time is coming that this gospel that you're hearing will be expected.
My God.
Then your portion of the children don't know which way, they're confused, don't know which way to go. Why? Because you didn't leave them something.
Oh God.
But if you leave them something, well, daddy got the right ring to it. Hey. I'm accepting that. Yeah. I don't know who preaching. Yep. But when you didn't leave them a legacy, then they don't know what to do, and the other preacher might sound good and he's quite philosophical and all this kind of stuff, and you will fall for it. You'll go for it. Because they're offering you something for nothing. You follow me. But that's why you go to the show. You know the gospel. Yes. You know what's right.
Amen.
And these children here ought to know what you imparted to them. And the people work around you.
Oh God.
They know what. Because you prove something by your upright life that you've never been in contact with before.
Mama.
And I'm going to tell you something. You will fool around here if you're uncareful. And your people that you impress so much, and you're doing it all, going to lose confidence in you. Because if you try to proclaim it, and you don't have it, even though you know that you should, you still try to proclaim it. You say, what are you doing?
My God.
Enough, Leo. Now you've got to try to reestablish your confidence. Or not. And then, too, and now, do you think they're going to put their life on something that you're not doing?
Yeah.
If it means, wait a minute, what's going on here? Are you demanding something of me that you're not doing? Predict the situation. That's what I'm looking at. After I'm dead and gone, we gotta effort here, our family. Call your family here. But I'm already believing my legacy. You know the gospel, you know the truth. Even though you're proclaiming and believing it, but you're not believing my legacy. Because you can't either which you don't possess. They can do the theory anyway. They can do the book and do the theory. But they can do the book and do the legacy. Follow me? So I think, children, that's going to teach them. And you better come on. When some of those things were standing, died. and get a couple out of it. You know, you don't know what it means. You got nobody to lean on. Because you can't accept it. Well, you know the truth, you can't accept it. You might try to trust yourself and go to TDJ and whoever. No. I'm going to tell you something, God. You got a responsibility to a legacy, leave a legacy. I'm going to tell you something. Leave a legacy. Everything. But I like that tricks your wife, whatever. Okay. My wife did a review. Let them mistreat their wife here to me. Hold it. Don't come to me with that. Don't come to me with that. You never saw death in a mess like this. You never saw money less than a slanderous word. You never saw me push her around and demean her and belittle her. You never saw that. And you never going to deal with it. And don't come to me for no sympathy. Don't come to me to come out of your dreams.
Hello,
and endure affliction.
Do the work of an evangelist.
Do the work of an evangelist.
Make full proof of thy ministry.
Make full proof of thy ministry.
For I am now ready to be offered.
There you go. There you go. There you go.
And the time of my departure is at hand.
Here we go. Now, you notice there's a striking similarity between Paul's last and Peter's. My departure's at hand. Paul said, now I'm ready to be offered up. I want you to do this. And both of their final remark was similar. They were strikingly similar. Okay, Peter said, I want you to remember this. And Paul said, wait a minute, after I leave, read the words come in. And pervert this gospel. They both said the same thing, and beware. Because he knew that. He knew because of the influence of the gospel. Right now, they would have some reluctance. But soon they leave, and they're going to do that. And they're going to even get a good audience because they will ask what they want. And I'm going to give you what you want. Come on. You might be mean this, and you might agree with it, but it's more than agreement. You need to have an affinity with it.
Right.
So that you can impart it to your children. So your children will have to accept nothing less than that.
That's right. I hear you.
Otherwise, they're going to be confused. You know, I like it when many of the same children come in and they know what to expect. You have to come, that's not necessarily, they know what to expect.
My God.
They're seeing it of their parents.
Right.
Even though they might not have been in church lately, but they're seeing it of their parents and they know it's real. They know it's real. And it so affect them that they're willing to separate from anything in this gospel. But now if we have cheapened it, diminished its worth, well then of course you can't take more from them. Come on.
For I am now ready to be offered.
Well, I'm ready. I've been faithful to this gospel. I finished the course. That's it. I'm ready now. See, I have another purpose for living, and I feel the same way. I said, now, there was some time before Jesus, we've been working so hard. I'm just tired and traveling. Where am I going?
That's right.
What I want to see. I can get a lot of almost new women up on Spencer Street. I'd like to go to Dubai and see that. You follow me? I said, you got to be thinking at the same. What would I want to do? Go someplace I've never been. So what? You find the same thing, they were the best people. anywhere but heaven. And you want to praise right to heaven. Go to heaven. Otherwise, come on with it.
For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith.
But listen. But what about his comrades? What about his preachers? They left him like Jesus did. Demons are left. Not only demons, you all overemphasize demons, but the rest of where the rest of them go. You know, all of them are something. But God still with you. Let me tell you what. You might be forsaken. But don't you worry about people forsaking you. It's the only one God.
Amen. Amen.
They don't have the last say about you. But God will. They can say it with this, you're that, or you're whatever, but you want. Let me tell you something. The Bible says you better be fearful. You better work with God to fear that you might be acceptable. Yes, like it. You want to be acceptable to God.
Amen.
And anything that you think might affect your acceptability with God, you better leave it alone. If you agree, leave it alone. If it's on the fence, leave it alone, because the fence belongs to the devil. Leave it alone. I got to wonder about it, and look and think about it, and I meditate on it, and push that in. All right? You tell me about it. Let's move on. My God. Give Revelation 6:9 quickly. Revelation 6:9.
And when he had opened the fifth seal, saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God.
You saw what? And where were they?
I saw under the altar the souls of them that were slain for the word of God and for the testimony which they held.
But where were they though?
under.
Under the altar. I can never get y'all on the altar. You know how they got under the altar? They got on the altar, and the Holy Ghost burned them up in ashes.
My God.
And see, ashes have no life giving. You can plant something in ashes, and nothing will go there. Why? Because what? It has no life giving stuff. He was God, but you have no flesh. There's no live flesh in you. There's no live flesh. When God brought you up to that, you didn't worry about back like the flesh is being burned up. And then he got under the altar. Well, he fell through the grace, and now it's under the altar. Oh, my God. Amen. You better have a spiritual cremation. Come on.
And when he had opened the fifth seal,
yes.
I saw under the altar
right.
the souls of them that were slain for the word of God
all right.
and for the testimony which they held.
You pray hard. You know why they were slain? You know why you were slain today? Verbally, if not otherwise, because you wouldn't turn loose your testimony. And you got them under conviction. When you hold on to it, now they're under conviction. But if they break you, you better be chummy. You better pray. If you hold on to this testimony, you'll have so much anywhere if there be common people around.
That's the truth.
You wouldn't turn it loose. If they turn it loose, we'll kill them. Jesus wouldn't turn loose to kill him. Paul wouldn't turn loose to kill him. People disdain you. But now, if you hold on to your testimony, you can make all these loud testimonies you want to, but hold on to it. I'm consecrated. I give up this. Hold on to it.
That's right.
The testimony is the hell. That's why I did what I checked myself. What I gave up 60 years ago, I don't want to look at it anymore.
Praise God.
One person I made a permanent will. I get a bigger perm. So, amen. The testimony was the hell. I gave it to God and I'm not taking it back.
Amen.
I gave myself my mind. I'm not going to think like it.
I'm
not going to involve myself like I used to. I dropped the net and I'm not going to pick it back up.
That's right.
Going back and digging up things that she left to me.
Lord, bless.
Went to a place of prayer in the church right about a month ago. Mm-hmm. And the leader, the chairman, cleavage, back out, pants loose in the quiet den. I thought nothing of it.
We love you, brother.
Those are the same people who once had this gospel here. They know the history. But what? So what? They're not an oddity. This is an analogy. This is an analogy. And this is the situation. And I told you about the little car between him and you. They kept worrying to me about buying it because it was a clean old car. And they kept bothering him, so I got to get these people off of me. And he put a sign, not for sale.
Amen.
Not for sale. Listen, now, you get a great big illuminated sign, and the devil come by and say, not for sale. And then you just get you some red bulbs and put it there. Not for sale. And guess what? And they know what you mean, bitch. And you might come back and you change your mind anyway. Yeah. What about that guy? What you hear a month ago here? Did I tell you I'm not for sale? Get out of my face. Roscoe, your name Roscoe? Yeah, Roscoe. You, what are you, Muskegon? Yeah. And you start hitting on me? Yeah. What I tell you? You better go about your business. You got your people messed up.
Amen.
You took your tail and go about your business. Not for sale. And people know when you're not for sale. They know what you mean. I give you $100 more for it. So it's not for sale. So money came back.
Amen.
Money came back. Love of God. The peace of God for you. Now, children, you can put, give me 1 Kings 15:9. And you can have a blighted legacy. A blighted legacy. A blighted
And in the 20th year of Jeroboam, king of Israel, reigned Asa over Judah.
Go on.
And 41 years reigned he in Judah.
Listen closely because we're coming to a conclusion. Come on with me.
And his mother's name was Maacah.
Come on.
And the daughter of Abishalom.
Yes.
And Asa did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord.
Did that which was right in the eyes of the Lord.
As David his father.
When he had David his father. Listen. Come on. Wait.
And he took away the Sodomites out of the land.
All right.
And removed all the idols that his father had made.
Yes.
And also Maacah, his mother, even her he removed from being queen.
Mm-hmm.
Because she made an idol in a grove.
Yes.
And Asa destroyed her idol,
mm-hmm,
and burned it by the brook of Kidron.
Come on.
But the high places were not removed.
All right.
Nevertheless, Asa's heart was perfect, mm-hmm, with the Lord all his days.
Come on.
And he brought in the things which his father had dedicated,
all right,
and the things which himself had dedicated,
mm-hmm,
into the house of the Lord,
all right,
silver and gold and vessels.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a war between Asa and
Judah. Okay, 15 about where David, 15 verse number 9, you knew that?
Yeah.
I think that's right.
15:9. And yes. In the 20th year of Jeroboam, king of Israel, reigned Asa over Judah.
Yeah. Verse 5. Come on with me.
Because David did that which was right.
Oh, here we go.
In the eyes of the Lord.
Which was right in the eyes of the Lord.
And turned not aside from anything that he commanded him.
Oh, my. No, it's not a complimentary close here. See, listen, come on.
And turned not aside from anything.
What?
That he commanded him.
That he commanded him.
All the days of his life.
All the days of his life.
Save only in the matter of Uriah the Hittite.
He had a perfect record. Only. He only had one inefficient, indelible situation. My God. Thank you.
That's right.
That's what you want.
Yuppie.
That's what I was doing. Move sounds like it. People come to pray for me. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. Thank God. You got anointing? Where am I speaking? And then I'm going to help wherever I'm going.